Okay, good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Harvard Divinity School. My name is Kevin Madigan. I teach history, and I'm associate dean here. And it's so good to see you all. This hour or 50 minutes, not hour and 50 minutes, this hour or more like 50 minutes, will really be dedicated to talking about the four programs we sponsor here at Harvard Divinity School. So I'm just going to introduce one of our professors at a time, one of our directors at a time, and he or she will speak for 5 minutes or so about the program that he or she oversees, and then we'll entertain questions from you for the remainder of the period. Okay? So first to my left here is Professor Charles Halsey. He's professor of South Asian studies, Asian studies, and with specialty in Buddhist studies, and he is director of the MTS program this year. So Charlie, I'll turn it right over to you.
Let me begin by saying it's a pleasure to welcome you all here to Harvard Divinity School today. I'm also sure that even though perhaps you're visiting Cambridge for the first time or you've just been here briefly, you've already found out about a number of things about Massachusetts, Cambridge, and Harvard. In part, we speak in our own way, and we do things in our own way. So we have squares that are invisible, as in Harvard Square, Inman Square, Central Square. We have a yard that is not a yard, as in Harvard Yard. We also talk about things that other people have, but in our own way. So other people live in states. We live in a commonwealth. Other people have milkshakes. We have fraps. If you go into a place and ask for a milkshake, you'll get shook milk. So other people have sprinkles that they put on their ice cream. We have jimmies. So all of these things are important things to know. Is it particularly important when you're thinking about a master of theological studies, which we refer to, like we refer to fraps and jimmies, where elsewhere people have other names. At other places, it's called a master of arts. Here, just because we're us, we call it a master of theological studies. There's reasons for that, but they're probably not important to you. There's reasons why the Commonwealth of Massachusetts is the Commonwealth and not the state of Massachusetts. But in terms of paying my taxes, I pay state income taxes. There's the state police and so on. And so in some sense, the words don't matter as much as the reality. So the great cultural critic and literary critic, Edward Said, that some of you may know from his book, Orientalism, said that it's possible to be a nominalist and a realist at the same time. Being a nominalist is that you don't expect words to point to a reality. Being a realist is that there is a reality. So one of the things that I would just recommend to you when thinking about our masters of theological studies is not to spend too much time thinking about the words. Why is it called theological studies? How is that different than religious studies? And instead, just to look at the reality of things that are here. What I've done is prepared a handout. It has information that you can find elsewhere. It's all over the place on the Harvard Divinity School website, on the student handbook. It goes through the program goals, and then also the area of focus that we have in the master of the MTS program. Sometimes these things are just things that people say, but I want to encourage you when you're thinking about your future to look at both the program goals and the area of focuses that we have and to take them as being pointers towards a certain kind of reality. The program goals are one of the ways that all of us here, students and faculty, administration, we think about what are the skills and virtues that will help you, as someone in the MTS program, to turn your own interests into something that is useful for others. And so one of the things that you can say is, oh, by looking at these things, it's one of the ways in which people together say, oh, this is how we turn things that are profoundly interesting to us as an individual into something that is good for other people. I remember when I was thinking about going to graduate school, You can look at the gray hair in my head and know it was a long time ago. That I spoke to a teacher about wanting to go on and study Buddhism, which I did. And he listened very carefully and he said, it all sounds really good. The only question I have is, what good is it for anyone else? That's a very, very important question. To go on to graduate school is in part to have your own interests, but it's also to answer questions about what good is it for someone else. When people speak about program goals, it's one of the ways that you start to turn your own personal interests into being something that you offer as a service to other people. The last two of the program goals, which seem immense and large, MTS graduates will be able to use their understanding of religion to engage creatively and critically in the contemporary practice of such fields as education, the arts, law, medicine, journalism, social service, social change, Hollywood actors, we can go on, Nobel Prize winners in physics. But then also to aspire to academic careers. All of this is just to say that we acknowledge that people come to the MTS programs envisioning very, very different futures for themselves. And that the program is designed not to create people with one future, but people imagining for themselves lots of different futures, all of which we're assuming are good for other people. But then one of the things to just say, when you're looking at the programs, you just say, oh, in some sense, I'm matching my own vision of what my interests are now and a vision of my future within things where people are saying, well, this is how we think reality is. And the reality is not just the present, but a future of things that we want to have happen. So that's why we speak about it as program goals. The area of focus are ways in which people divide up. Someone's in Buddhist studies, someone's in theology, someone's in New Testament studies. And all of these things are useful ways of kind of locating yourself in the world. And they're helpful for you about thinking about a reality. It might be an occasion that you see me with a young woman, and you say to me, who is that? And I say, she's my sunshine. But then Kevin, who knows her, says, it's his daughter. She is my sunshine. But it is much more helpful to you to know that she's my daughter. So one of the things that when you see the area of focus, what they are names that we use in the world to locate ourselves, like saying, this is my daughter. I do Buddhist studies. I do South Asian studies. What it means, what's helpful for you in terms of, you know, thinking about reality, is that it helps you to ask yourself, what are my secondary interests? What I'm most interested in Buddhist studies, I can tell you, and you probably, you know, you say, well, what is that? So I'm really interested in Totogamoe Sri Rahula. And probably all of you are saying, what is that? And so, as you should. But one of the things when I say I'm in Buddhist studies, I'm also saying to myself, I'm interested in anything that people say about the study of Buddhism. I want to hold up my end of the conversation and be able to listen to them and say, oh, that's interesting. So sometimes when you're thinking about the area of focus for the MTS, don't only focus on what is most interesting to you, but ask yourself what I'm interested in a secondary way or in a third way. And that will tell you really important things about yourself. So that you might be able to do what you're most interested in about 7 or 8 different areas of focus. But your second or third interest, you would say, there's really only one. I'm not interested in everything about that. I'm only interested in this. And so that's one of the things where you say, oh, these are not just names for area of focus. They're guides to helping you to discover realities about yourself, in which then you can offer to other people. This is what good I have to give to you. I guess at the end, we have time for questions.
Yeah, we'll entertain questions at the end. Thank you so much, Charlie. I should say, although my daughter is Charlie's sunshine, she is 17. In the midst of adolescence, she's far from my sunshine. I have to crouch under the stairs every evening when she comes in to see what kind of mood she's in. And so it's good to see your happy, optimistic faces to know that you do come out the other side at some point. Maybe 5 years down the line, 3 if I'm lucky.
I refer to my daughter as sunshine, and he refers to his daughter as not sunshine.
Exactly right. Thanks so much, Charlie. So I'd like to introduce Professor Dudley Rose. Dudley is the director of the Master of Divinity program and teaches many courses in ministry studies. He also has a special interest in Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Dudley.
All right. Thank you, Kevin. I'll be not nearly as poetic as Charlie. I apologize if I'd realized that he was going to give you this wonderfully hermeneutically interconnected talk. I would have tried to prepare one myself. But let me, how many people here are intending to apply to the MTS degree? Okay. What we know about you is if you are accepted, a significant portion of you will, by the end of your first year, apply to go into the MDiv degree. Now, I'm telling you that not to recruit you into the MDiv degree, though I'm sometimes accused of that, but to help you, first of all, pay attention to this part of our program, and to think about your application more broadly than you might think of it, because as Charlie said, at Harvard we do things differently, and one of the things that we do differently at the Divinity School than most other Divinity Schools is the Master of Divinity program. It's different because it's an interreligious program. It's not simply for people who are preparing for Protestant Christian ministry, which is what MDiv programs were originally devised to do. You can prepare for ministries in a number of religious traditions. That obviously will mean different things for different traditions. We don't have credentialing connections with many of the Buddhist organizations or affiliations in the same way that we do with Protestant denominations, but nonetheless we have many students who are in our Buddhist MDiv program preparing for careers in chaplaincy, and some of them in fact who will be ordained by lineages or other adjudicatories. Let me just give you a sample from our last year's graduating class in terms of the careers that students in the MDiv go into. That will help, I think, give you a sense of the breadth. We still do, you'll be glad to know, prepare people for ministry. A full third of our MDiv students are planning ordained ministry. Another almost 15% are going into chaplaincy, so they will have very similar kinds of preparation in many respects, and another 5% into lay ministry. So you can see that probably half of the class is connected to that traditional notion of what the degree is. But we have a significant percentages that go into business, community development. We have a very significant percentage who go on to doctoral work. So people go out of the MDiv into doctoral degrees. It's not simply the case that MTS prepares students for doctorates. We have a lot of MDivs who do that. Folks will go into education, teaching in secondary schools, maybe being chaplains in colleges or universities. And some will go into fields as far-flung as the news media, public policy, business, law, so lots of other professions. What that can tell you, I think, about the MDiv degree is the breadth of the way in which people ask that question that Charlie wanted to pose to you of what good am I going to do? What can I do in this world? The answer to that question, of course, is as broad as and as manifold as are you. And many of those answers can be accomplished best in the MDiv program. So I want you to think about that as you apply to which program you choose. Let me just say a little bit about how we configure the MDiv program so that you'll have a sense of what you would be asked to study here. We center it around three broad areas, and those areas are centered themselves around a religious tradition. So you choose a religious tradition in which you are planning to minister or study. For some of you, that will be difficult, and we'll have interesting conversations because you have multiple religious belonging and so on. But just for a moment, just think of it as simply you choose a religious tradition and then the degree centers around sacred texts of that tradition, the histories, theologies, and practices of that tradition, and then a requirement to study at least one, usually two or more other religious traditions. And we have a whole set of distributions that cover each of those three broad areas. Since our requirements are largely distribution requirements, that means that you have a great deal of latitude in choosing courses among them. We have required courses at this point, two in your first year, one in your final year, and two units of field education that have to be done, but those can also be done in many different environments that, throughout the city and even further away from the city. The other thing that we design the program around or organize it around are arts of ministry. That's again a term that you won't hear in a lot of places. I believe the origin of it here, which some of you may know, the old New Testament scholar Christer Stendahl, who was a professor and dean here, and thought of that as a way to talk about skills in a more capacious way than just simply skills, as arts and arts of ministry. There are six of them. They're available. I'll just quickly run through them, but don't worry about trying to remember them, and know again that we draw these quite capaciously, because one of them, for example, is religious education. For some people, that might be religious education in a church, but it might very well be religious education in teaching in a sangha or in a secondary school. So it has all kinds of breadth built in, but they are preaching and or worship, pastoral care and counseling, religious education, administration and program development, public leadership, and denominational policy. You will earn three of those at a minimum in your time here, and you earn them by addressing them in a field placement and in a course. And this is one of the places where you may want to think about what degree program works best for you. One of the ways in which the MDiv is different from the MTS is that it has built into it this kind of integrative function in which you are working in placements and you are also connecting your field work with that work. Now, not connecting it in some cases explicitly, but at least in terms of integrating it in your own thinking. That sometimes is a real interesting challenge. We want you to be putting together disparate things and making them talk to each other. We want you to go to Greek in the morning and go to Children's Hospital in the afternoon and try to figure out why you did those two things that day together. So that's the kind of question we're going to be asking of you. Finally, I'll just say we do have a language requirement in the MDiv program that is three courses in a language that you choose, and those three courses are not, you can't test out. In other words, you can have very high language skills, and we still want you to take three courses in language. The reason we do that, there are actually several, but one that I will just mention is that by studying a language which has a different syntax, a different vocabulary, a different cultural milieu, it asks you to be working across difference in a very explicit and oftentimes difficult way. That we see as a value in the MDiv program and in human relationship in general.
Dudley, thank you so much. I'd like now to introduce Annie Russell. Annie is our fairly new registrar, although here only about a year. She knows more than any of us here about program requirements. And she has a serious special interest in the history of baseball. One of the other unique things about Massachusetts is that our local baseball team had a fairly successful season this year, about which Annie is quite proud. So Annie, over to you. I should say, she's going to talk about the THM program, the Master of Theology program, and maybe some baseball.
And Kevin, I will refrain from and in deference to knowing that many of you in this audience probably have less than positive thoughts or feelings about the Red Sox based on where you're from. I will refrain. I would like to ask if there is anyone here right now who has an interest in the Master Theology program. Okay. Okay, okay, okay. So for many of you, some of these remarks will, you can shuffle your papers and move on. But Charlie, I think, gave us a great framework, and gave me a great framework for talking about the THM degree. Because the THM is really a program, a one-year program of advanced study, which presupposes that you have already received one of the degrees that my colleagues have already discussed. And the THM degree, like the MTS degree, has those areas of focus. So you are looking at a THM as something to expand your horizons, your interests, perhaps your own change, perhaps a change in career goal. If you have, for example, been in ordained ministry and are looking to expand your knowledge base, if you have the professional degree and you're thinking of further academic study and need to have a more in-depth way of looking at it, the THM degree enables those of you who already have that master's degree to spend a year in intensive study in one of those areas of focus that either it's a passion that you have, something that lights your fire, or something that you want to dig deeper into, something that's always been there in the back of your mind in terms of expanding your experiences. The THM, as I said, is an intensive program, so it's 1 year of full-time study. It also does have, as does the MDiv and the MTS degree, also does have a language requirement. You work with an academic advisor in a more relational one-on-one fashion. Part of that is the culmination of your experience is with an oral exam, unlike the MDiv, which has a thesis requirement. The MTS has an oral exam requirement, in which you have an examination by a committee of the faculty, based upon the submission of approximately 50 to 60 pages of in-depth research material. And that is the starting point and the focus of the questioning for the 1 hour oral final. And at the end of this year of intensive full-time study, you are awarded the degree. So it's a little more compact, it's a little more straightforward, but in the same way that the MTS allows you to explore that greater good, not for yourself, but for others, so does the THM in a concentrated and intense fashion for people who are already have the professional degree.
Terrific. Thanks so much, Annie. And finally, I'd like to introduce Maritza Hernandez. Maritza is another one of our omnicompetent administrators. Her official title is Associate Dean for Student Services. And if you come here, you'll be seeing a lot of her. But she's kindly agreed today to talk about the doctorate that we confer, the Doctor of Theology degree, or THD. Maritza.
Thank you, Kevin. And good morning, everyone. Welcome. Mm-hmm. It's nice to see you. I'm sure that actually the faculty on the panel will be able also to talk quite a bit about the THD. But as Charlie mentioned, it's the name of is very particular to HDS. Our THD would be the equivalent of a PhD anywhere else. But because of historical reasons and the way Harvard is organized, here at the Divinity School, we award the THD. And so to give you a definition, the THD program trains students in the appropriate linguistic, historical, comparative, analytical, or constructive skills for research and teaching in religious and theological studies. Its scope includes religious traditions of the world, the relation between religion and culture, the self-understanding of distinct religious traditions, and the interpretation of any one religious tradition in relation to other traditions and to the study of religion in general. Students applying to the THD program need to indicate on their application the field, their primary specialization, and they have the following are the ones that you would choose from: comparative religion, ethics, Hebrew Bible, Old Testament, New Testament, early Christianity, religion and society, religion, gender and culture, and theology. The program is characterized because of its diversity of religious traditions that it studies, that our students are studying, the diversity of theoretical approaches employed. And so, like I said, it's the equivalent of a PhD somewhere else, and also the PhD that's offered at the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, which is overseen by the same committee, the Committee on the Study of Religion. So both the THD and PhD are overseen by the same committee. So the programs, both programs are designed to give you height and depth. The depth is philosophical and methodological tools that it provides. The height is in sort of the required courses that you are taking in your first year, as well as the general examinations that you take in the third year of the program. So you'll come up with theory and method able to teach in a college, seminary, or university, ready to think about liberal arts, social sciences, humanities, and the place of religion and theology within them broadly. The degree, the length to degree is anywhere from 5 to 7 years. The first 2 years are coursework that you're taking. Then you take your generals, usually in the third year of the program. Then you, the prospectus, and once that's approved, you move on to your thesis. And many of our cohort tends to be on the PhD program between 5 and 6 students each year, and it's about the same on the PhD at GSAS. For those of you that are not sure, or where the fields are also, I guess, crossover to GSAS, you are encouraged to apply to both. You can apply to the THD and the PhD programs. And so the last thing I want to say about the THD program is that in HDS is that it's a transformative place. Yeah, your teachers, your professors will transform you, even as we as even as they are transformed and the rest of us are transformed by each of you. The professors here are wonderful, fantastic teachers and advisors, profound writers and thinkers, producing inspiring work. As one of their colleagues once said to me, no one wants to be a slouch in this crowd. And so even more, you'll transform each other. And I think this is true of all our programs. The students in all the degree programs are an amazing group of students that transform each other and you learn from each other. So that's the power of being here in the classroom. So that's I briefly the THD program. I would encourage you if you have questions. Catherine Kunkel, I notice, is also in the audience. She's the coordinator for the THD program. So if you have very specific questions about applications and the process, I would certainly encourage you to talk to her. So thank you.
Great. Thank you so very much, Maritza. We have plenty of time for questions, so what I'm going to do is, in order to be as fair as possible, just move across the room, starting over here, moving back and forth, and if you would just ask your question with the microphone. Anybody over here? Yeah.
Hi, I'm interested in the MTS program, particularly the concentration with religion, ethics, and politics. I'm looking for basically the nexus between public policy and religion and law in my graduate school programs. So I'm curious about what HDS students with those interests, if there are, what sort of vocational experiences they pursue maybe through the summers or just opportunities in Boston to prepare themselves for a career.
There's two parts to answering the question. One is that one of the advantages of the MTS program is the fact that Harvard Divinity School is part of Harvard University, and there's a variety of other schools in the university that are doing teaching and then research that's related to areas of focus that are in the MTS program. So the kinds of interests that you're talking about, both the law school and the Kennedy School, as well as the Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, would be relevant. There's a certain number of courses that can be taken outside of half at any given term. One of the things that's just been kind of approved for the MTS program is that MTS students can also do field education work, like the MDiv students, and have a count for course credit. So working in a variety of places that may serve you to prepare for a career like that, in a nonprofit or some kind of think tank, or a variety of things that are in the Boston area, you could say, oh, now that will become possible. Then what people do beyond, there may be a variety of things that people do. Some of it, you could say, well, they end up working in nonprofits that are in areas that they're particularly interested in. Other people end up going to something like law school. Others go into working in Washington, D.C., a variety of lobbying. I'm a graduate of Harvard Divinity School, and so my roommate from then became a lobbyist in Washington, D.C., and he had very similar interests to what you were talking about.
Somebody from the center. Yeah, please.
Can you talk a little bit more about field education and opportunities, and specifically any international opportunities for field education?
Mm-hmm. I think that's probably for me. The question is to say a little bit more about field education and to address specifically international opportunities. So let me start with the latter. Most of the international opportunities for field education, just by logistics, happen during the summer. Field education here is a 350 to 400 hour experience, and so it's either part-time, 10 to 12, 13, 14 hours a week during the academic year, or relatively full-time during the summer. We have an application process for selecting students and approving summer placements in field education across really across the globe. And it tends to be student-driven, that is, students identify placements that they're interested in. In part, we find that is necessary because students have such wide interest and come to us with organizations that they're interested in working with. We do have a growing number where we've had students who repeat to those. And as Charlie was just saying, in terms of the kind of work that folks can do in the MTS, it would be the same. You could work in nonprofit organizations. You could work on the service side. You could work on a policy side. You could work on a teaching side. There are lots of different ways in which you could be involved with various organizations. It's a two-step process for the summer. One is the approval of the site educationally, that we believe that the learning possibilities are solid, that you'll have good supervision, that the place is a good place for you to go in general. And then we have a limited number of grants to help pay the way for students to go into some of these placements. Some of them are funded by geographic area, so there are certain kinds of limitations in all that we're doing. But often students will have an organization that will pay them, or they have some other arrangement, and the stipend is not necessary for it to be approved as a field education placement. Does that give you what you were looking for?
Please. Can I just add, though, that Dean Madigan said that Dudley Rose's special interest is in Bonhoeffer. Many of you know that his famous book is Letters and Papers from Prison, and he does recommend a prison sentence as a good field education site.
Please.
Thank you very much. I have two quick questions. Firstly, I will take the bait and ask why exactly the MTS students do and so many end up transferring into MDiv. And my second question is kind of how does HDS work with Harvard's other schools and what kind of opportunities are there for students in terms of coursework and research? And realistically, how flexible is that? Thank you.
Well, let me start. I think others are going to want to answer at least the second question. The first question is a little hard to answer in any kind of a universal way, but I would say that there are a few threads that are pretty common. One is that between the time a student applies and the time they come to make this turn, they've had a change of direction in their vocational interests. They didn't think they were called to some kind of ordained ministry, for example, and they now all of a sudden have a sense as they've begun to study that is what they are called to do. That's probably the most straightforward case. For others, I think it is that essential integration of the work of ministry and the intellectual work of your in the classes that the degree sort of foregrounds, and this is where it gets complicated here, because as Charlie was just saying, the MTS students can do field education. There are lots. You're sitting in the same classes if you're in the MTS or MDiv program. It's not like they're siloed in any particular way. But we find that there are some students who want to do more of those practice-oriented courses, who want to have a curriculum that continues to ask questions of them that force them to put those two areas together. We have many students who come and say to me, because I'm one of the gatekeepers, we make sure that people really are making a good change for themselves educationally, who will say something to the effect that I have this part of my life that I've devoted and I do devote to public service, to doing things that I just will find better able to integrate in the MDiv program. So those are some of the kinds of reasons that people do. And it's why I say to think about it, because they are. They're very closely, you can do either degree and do many of the vocations that I read out here, right? Mm-hmm. So it's not as if the separation between them is a bright line. And let me just speak for the MDiv, and I think some of this will apply to the others in terms of courses across Harvard. Most of our programs, the master's programs, the MTS and the MDiv specifically, are the requirements are largely distribution requirements. And we are really trying very hard to live into this notion of one Harvard, so that if there's something in FAS or in the Kennedy School and so on that you want to take, generally speaking, if it's related to what you're studying, you will be able to earn even distribution, not just elective credits for those. You're allowed to take as many as half of your courses outside of the Divinity School. Half also, no more than half in any one term. But that gives, many of our students are cross-registering into courses at several of the professional schools and arts and sciences. And we have what may be of interest to some of you, particularly in ministry areas, the Boston Theological Institute, which is a consortium of 10 theological schools, cemeteries. Yeah. Seminaries and one rabbinical school that you can also cross-register into.
And I would just add, as the person who administers the cross-registration, both for what Dudley described with the Boston Theological Institute and across Harvard University, that in general, with the Faculty of Arts and Sciences, Graduate School of Arts and Sciences, the Kennedy School, the Law School, the Business School, those are the areas that our current students have the greatest interest in cross-registering. There's a great synergy there, and there is a reciprocal openness. Obviously, if you wanted to take clinical brain surgery at the med school, you probably couldn't cross-register into that. But in my brief experience here, there is that synergy that Dudley referred to, and we now administratively continue to make it a less onerous process as well for students to discover what courses would at other Harvard schools and colleges would fit into a student's particular interest, as well as to make that process of of registration and grading a lot more seamless.
I also like to add that that HDS has one of the most generous cross-registration policies in allowing at least half of the courses to be taken outside of HDS. But we also have a growing number of students that are pursuing concurrent degrees, joint degrees with the other professional schools. So we have several students that are doing the Master of Public Policy at the Kennedy School and an MTS or an MDiv here. Also students with the law school and us. And so there's also that opportunity to, if that's an interest and you feel you need the credentials, based on your career trajectory, that's also an option.
Thanks. Please.
First of all, I'd like to thank the panel for sharing your wisdom. And one of the things that definitely attracted me to the Harvard Divinity School was the interdisciplinary approach. Having said that, my question is specifically for Professor Rose. With the MDiv, kind of a two-part question. Part A, what percentage of the MDiv students that matriculate end up doing the doctorate in theology here at Harvard versus leaving to go to other doctoral programs? Mm-hmm. And part B, what would you recommend in terms of master preparation for the doctorate in theology?
I'm not probably going to be able to give you a specific or a accurate estimate of how many do the doctoral programs here. As Maritza said, the cohorts for the doctoral program at Harvard are small, 5 to 7 a year. There are always a handful of those who are MDiv students, so it's a very high representation. But I think realistically, we have, say, 50 to 60 people graduating. Some significant percentage of those will be going into doctoral programs. They can't all do it here. And there are many other fine doctoral programs across the country. So I think that we appreciate the interest, and many of our students do it, but I would not consider your 3 years of the MDiv a failure if you ended up at Emory or somewhere else for doctoral work. Others can answer the kinds of things that MDiv students in particular are going to do to prepare themselves for doctoral work. I think is to imagine what doctoral career it is, what area and how they want to approach it that is going to combine typically theological and religious studies. Most people who are doing the MDiv are looking at that kind of integrative way of thinking about normative issues, about practices of ministry in some fashion. And so whatever coursework particularly, but other things that help them at a very high level, think about those theoretically, to think about them in terms of, especially I think theoretically, you're going to need to be able to be a good theoretician to get into the doctoral programs here. I don't know if others would.
May I ask Charlie to augment that? Can you add anything else?
I imagine that lots of people here today are thinking about a future that includes doctoral study. And then one of the dangers for everyone at this moment is kind of thinking, oh, what is it that people are looking for? And then I'll do that. But the problem for that, I would say, for all of you, is it's your life that you have to live. And so if you're doing things just that other people are telling you, if it was my life, I would do this. That's a road to misery for you. But the other thing is that it's not the sure way to get into a doctoral program either. I have an MDiv, but I'm in Buddhist studies. One of the things that I would say sets me apart from my other professional colleagues in Buddhist studies, I can trace to having been a hospital chaplain and how that changed with the way that I think religion works in human lives. And so then you would say, oh, does that mean the best way to get a PhD in Buddhist studies is to become a hospital chaplain? No. But it served me very well. And I would say, people pick that up and they say, oh, he talks about stuff differently. Why? And I would say, it's listening to people who were terminally ill. That gave me something that I began to understand, this is what Buddhists are talking about. And so that's one of the things that I would say, really listen to stuff that is calling you, but then speak about how it is good for other people. And that's why it's good to look at, say, program goals and requirements and things like that. But don't just decide, I'm going to fulfill these goals, because then you'll just be very boring and bland. And so instead, to just say, I have interests here that no one else does.
One more question?
Sure. How about right here?
I have four very short, extremely short questions, and I'll just put them out there. One is, and this is about the MTS and the MDiv, does one have a larger applicant pool than the other? Question two, if so, is one more competitive than the other, although both are very competitive, but is it harder to get into one than the other? Question three, do MTS students receive the same amount of financial support for the program as the MDiv students? And the fourth, which is the least related, is in regards to the MDiv, what attracts me about the MTS is the areas of focus. And as a potential MDiv student, what I have to jettison the hope of concentrating in, say, philosophy of religion, because that only applies to the MTS and possibly not the MDiv. So,
great. Thanks so much. For your first couple of questions, I'm going to invite our Director of Admissions. Emrita, fine, absolutely.
So the questions about admissions, there's one committee that reviews the applications for both MDiv and MTS. So it's one criteria. We're reviewing the applications based on that criteria. And so it's competitive for both programs. Regarding the financial aid, we have financial aid for all. Our financial aid is very generous. Mm-hmm. And even though we have limited resources, given our size school, we are able to give the lowest grant that we give based on need is half tuition, up to full tuition, and that is very rare at graduate schools. Most graduate schools are not able to provide very much in grant-based funding. So we're very proud of that, and that is for both the MTS and the MDiv. There are some scholarships that are in particular just for the MDiv, but we are very conscious to make sure that we are working to make this degree affordable for all the degree students, both in the MDiv and the MTS program. Having said that, it's also very expensive to live in this area, and we're not able to cover the full cost of attendance, so we describe it as a partnership where we're also relying on you to do your part and do research for funding and thinking about how you're going to fund this education. So we're going to support you as best we can and provide resources, but we're also looking for you to do your part as well. So hopefully that answers that question.
So let me just address the areas of focus question. Here, I think, again, you're going to be served well to figure out what it is that you really want to do and then see if the program really allows you to do that in the way you want to or it's being shoehorned in. So the simple answer is there would not be a problem in finding philosophy of religion courses which would fulfill distribution requirements. Right? You're going to need to do field education. You're going to need to do arts of ministry. You're going to need to do other religions. So there are a number of other things that you will be doing, some of which will be able to fit into that same schema. But you know, I would be careful about saying I have this focus of study without looking carefully at the other requirements that you will face, and do they may in fact be exactly what you want to do, but I would want you to be clear that that was the case. One of the things, and this is just one's a two-year degree program, the other's a three-year degree program. It's not like you get a free extra year. Well, it's not free anyway, but it's not like you get it. It's not like you get an extra year because there are enough other of these kinds of requirements that I've just listed. So you're not going to get another year of philosophy of religion courses, for example.
Okay, I think we have to wrap it up. I think all of us would like to thank you for your attention and to wish you the best of luck as you think about the right university and the right program for you, and hope to see you. Lots of you anyway, here this coming fall.